in this project. I was very excited to find out my first speaker is somebody I've admired for quite a while. He's a better footballer than me, he's a much better chess player, he's a very strong grandmaster, and he's represented his country at football, playing for Norway. And I would have liked to have seen the great goal he showed us before, but the Wi-Fi connection wasn't quite working. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Simen Agdestein as our first speaker.
Because I've been asked these questions so many times, the similarities between chess and football and so on. I was asked that all the time when I was 20 years old and played both. And I just answered different things every time. Didn't really reflect deeply upon it. And I'm sure anyone, probably you, have much more clever thoughts about similarities and so on. My approach is very practical, because I was just playing both. And I tried to put together a kind of a presentation. But I think I would need a little bit of assistance. But it's not that professional, again. I could perhaps start with a little presentation of myself, because I did play football and soccer, right? When I was about 20. Also the national team. Sunday I played on the national team, which was a bit of a surprise, because I was basically a chess player. And then suddenly I appeared on the national team. And I even had a little trial in Aberdeen, as you have noticed somehow. It was stressful. I had people from Queen's Park Rangers coming watching me. I played horrible then because of the stress. I would have loved to have more experience. To be an experienced footballer would have been wonderful. Unfortunately, I didn't get that feeling because I injured myself very early, so I had to quit after just a couple of years in the limelight, so to speak. I got 8 matches for Norway, and it was just in a period when Norway suddenly became very good. Soon after we beat England, it was incredibly luck. And in 10, that was incredible luck. Kjetil Rekdal scored with the left goal, left foot.
Winston Churchill, that's what the commentator said.
That was another one. That was another one, I remember that too. That's another one, very famous clip. You were incredibly lucky. I played with Kjetil Rekdal, who was the one who scored that goal, if you remember that goal. I played with him at the under-21 national team. And Jan Åge Fjørtoft. Did he play in England? No. I played with Ronny Johnsen, he played in the same club as me in Manchester United. And Henning Berg. Actually, even became professional, it was a big surprise. It was a big boom for Norway those days. And the main reason for that big boom was Egil Olsen. We had a wonderful coach. I don't know if you heard of him. He wasn't so successful in England, I think.
Wimbledon,
yeah. Actually, I worked together with Trond Andersen, a Norwegian player for Wimbledon. Not very famous, but he actually has 36 matches for Norway. I hadn't even heard of him. When he suddenly appeared next door to him, because I work at NTG, Norges Topp Idrettsgymnas. It's a sports school, which has been a wonderful arena, perfect arena, for Magnus Carlsen and maybe 100 other full-time. It's part of a school.
So when you say a sports school, was that football and chess? Do they
chess? Yeah, football is the biggest sport. It's about 15 sports.
Yeah.
I think.
But did they have people there to play chess as and counting that, or was it purely?
I came in there, this school, and I don't know if you see the sports here, but there are different all kinds of sport, alpine, basketball, not all kinds, but a few. And chess, shack, which means. We have when the others play or do sailing or whatever, we play chess. It's 10 hours per week approximately. 2.5 hours every morning, except Fridays. We change chess. And I have a group of 10 or 11 people, or sometimes only 5. It's not that easy, even in Norway. Chess is a fantastic boom and a lot of attention, but it's not easy running at getting students to start with the school. So very, very difficult. But my main perspective is that I think I've learned a lot from all this other sports. I've been in meeting with all the trainers every week, and I've learned with them every day. It's a lot of connections, or we can learn from each other. Eventually, I came. You should go to listen to my partner, Olga Dolshikova. We have made this side stormes. But a Russian woman, this woman here, she's also having a few presentations here. We're partners, so we also organize lots. All the things you're doing, talking about here, is relevant for us. We're doing the same thing. It's not only for the top, but for Magnus Carlsen and those things. You have chess courses for 1,000 kids per semester and so on. The same, very nice tournaments. This is all the things we organize. This is on our agenda. This all the things here. Registrations. So we do lots of things. I do lots of things, different things. Having a speech. I'm often I travel around and doing a speech on because every former. Athlete kind of had a presentation. What can we learn from my experience as a former star of something? So I often travel around and talk about what we can learn from Magnus Carlsen, my experience with Magnus. And that seems to be interesting for of general interest, even for people who's not interested in chess. But here, the topic is chess and football, which is I'm not so familiar with actually. I tried to find some similarities. I need to have it's of course you have to look at that from a coach perspective. Of course, you cannot kind of think the players are chessmen. And the coach is the player, chess player. Then it becomes kind of interesting, because and also it's a zero game, some game I call it, rather win or lose. And this is a draw. Not like skiing or other sports where you kind of compete with yourself. It's a boxing fight. And lots of things can be added here, I'm sure. And I'm sure you have many thoughts about that. But I'm not sure if it's so interesting to me coming with such thoughts. I was also thinking a little bit about this, what footballers can learn from chess. Actually, I was invited to the Football Federation in Norway, not to speak actually, but they wanted to play chess. It's very easy to sell sell chess for events like that. I come home. I often have a good concept is having me having 5 minutes, and them having 10, and I play 10 players at a time. That's a good rush. That means I have half a minute on average per player, and that I will probably win 8 games or something. I will definitely lose a game or 2, and that's a good concept that can easily be sold. I haven't really experienced any footballers. Being interested in our thoughts, how did we kind of create Magnus Carlsen and so on. The footballers are very happy with themselves very often. I don't know if it's how it's like here, but they know best. They're not really interested in learning from anyone, is my experience, because they know best. It's the same at my school, actually.
Yeah.
We all have lunch to sit together and communicate, and with the footballers sit together with themselves. They're a group of five or six coaches, and they don't mingle and exchange things in the same way, because football is so big. It's the best. They know best. Is it like that? But I often use football metaphors when I try to teach people chess. And especially this, the center perspective. And chess is very simple. And center and development, that's the two things I focus on when I talk to beginners and its presentations for people. And just compared with football, it's important to control the center, then you control the whole field. Although I must admit, sometimes I wonder the importance of these incredible tackles and around the midfield. Why is it so important? The important thing is happening in front of the goal, before the goal, in front of the goals, not in the midfield. But it is actually important, I think. Also in football, and definitely in chess. And of course, you have to all human active development, center and development, which is similar. You have to maximize the potential of every player, which is obvious in chess. And of course, obvious in football too, very obvious. And it's good to utilize the scope of your opponent's players, prophylactic thinking. I wasn't thinking that much prophylactic, I must say, when I was a footballer. But sometimes our coaches analyzed our opponents and thought they have a good something and you have to stop him and so on. But I was quite selfish. I was just thinking about myself, I think, when I played soccer. But what I thought was more interesting, what can chess learn from football? And then I started thinking, because that's a lot, I think, actually, because after all, they believe they are the best, but maybe they are the best, because they get so much attention, so easy to recruit anyone to play soccer, I guess, especially here or everywhere. They have something. So then I started thinking a little bit about that. My old team captain wasn't that fantastic as a footballer, but I remember he said something like this: you can learn something from everyone. And that's something I've taken with me. You can learn something from everyone. And especially, so it's, for me, it's been very useful with all these different athletes or former world stars who has had presentations at our school. It's always something to learn. From everyone, actually. So we have to just keep your mind open. And especially from coaches, who have this human insight. But then it becomes kind of as a chess coach, I think it's interesting what the football coaches were doing. Because they were, after all, working with people. And that's the same thing for me. When I just think of myself as a chess player, I just work with chess. It's not no one disturbing anything. But as a chess coach, I work with people. And then it's extremely. Then I've been thinking. I think I got a lot from the some of my previous trainers. For instance, Egil Olsen, the coach I mentioned. Yeah, I was so lucky to have him as a coach for 4 years at my local club. We were only in the second highest division at the time. And I was kind of more into chess. I wanted to play chess. And I could play chess as much as I wanted. Because he allowed it. And it was no problem going away for 2 weeks. Because he said he saw that when I came home, I was kind of meditating or something for a couple of weeks. And I was in top shape after a couple of weeks off, actually. But he is the man behind the Norwegian football revolution, which lasted maybe for 8 years or something. Before it was very bad, and after it's been quite bad. But during him, he was extremely successful with Norway. He wasn't so successful with Wimbledon. I think it's sometimes a coach can be extremely good. It's not about it's about the relationship, and so it's the same with everyone, I guess. Sometimes the relationship is wonderful, sometimes you have some problems with the coach. But sometimes how we didn't succeed in Wimbledon, he succeeded in Norway with the Norwegian mentality. And what he did was to make people believe in themselves. It's very obvious. This was so much before and after Drillo, as we call him, in Olsen. For instance, I've noticed this. I will never forget it. He used to have tickets because he was into the Chess Federation and used to have tickets for national matches. And he asked me then, do you want to join for a match? It was just him and me. And I was maybe 18 years old or something. And I saw Norway scoring a goal. And I was racing, like a run on someone. Whoo! And then Drillo, you used to call him Drillo. It's a slang, yeah. He was just sitting there and it's just you could also have done that. He was saying small things like that. It wasn't. He was like that. He kept. He made you believe in yourself. And since then, I can also become world champion. Yes, of course. Of course, Magnus can also become world champion. Of course, I can manage to turn on the TV. Everyone else manages it. Although it's very, very difficult to turn on the TV sets. You can kind of break the barriers. There were no barriers suddenly in your mind. When you have a person like that around you, saying small things like that. No big words or anything. I don't think he managed to get that thing with him in Wimbledon. And then, actually, it did happen. I think you have to think first. I have here. I wouldn't say necessarily it's my biggest moment in life, but fairly big. That was it. It was only a few seconds. But I will never forget it. I scored one goal for Norway. It was against the old Czechoslovakia. That was a big moment. Eilertsen, you could also have done that. And here, afterward, then Eilertsen actually quit as a coach for my club. He found a woman, it was some problems, he had to get away from Oslo. And he tried a local club in Norway, it wasn't very big. It wasn't that successful either, and then he became national coach. But then we had another coach. He was really brilliant. Our trainers were so primitive. He just gave us a ball and we started playing. It was like that. But he did what Eilertsen didn't succeed with. He managed to get us up to the highest division by just talking. It was talking us up to the highest division. Things he said to us. It was like Eilertsen, but just another version. It was better, actually. And the psychological aspect is so incredibly important when you perform something. And that's good to take with you, I think, from the sport. He said things like this: you aren't better than what you perform in the next match. Who cares about rating? What you've done before doesn't really matter. For instance, now they're talking about crisis for Magnus Carlsen. People call me, newspapers and so on. I don't really understand what they're talking about because the focus is always on the next match. What they've done before doesn't really exist. Barely exists. Which is a little different from the Russian approach, I think, because they're supposed to learn from your mistakes, I believe. And that means you have to analyze your mistakes. Remember Magnus worked with Kasparov when he was 14 years old. He was given the task to analyze four games, four losses, at least 4 hours every game. And of course Magnus didn't want to do that, so that destroyed the whole project there and then. And Magnus was 14. He had the chance to work with Kasparov. The apple is soon rotten, Kasparov said. It was very important with what you were doing at that time. But I think we did better than Kasparov. We did it our way. You can't argue with success. And I think it's very important to learn to kind of dwell, is it called dwell? Linger on your successes, linger on your wins. And think about your wins, not spend any losses, or it was just bad luck. And forget it as soon as possible. And then a new chance next match, that's what matters. You have to look upon yourself as a winner. I mean, that means it's much better spending a lot of time on your wins than your awful losses. Just forget those horrible moments in your life, is my suggestion. Destroys the self-confidence quite enormously, actually. At least mine. And I've done a lot of mistakes, so I know what I'm talking about. And this also Petr Thordarson. I don't know if he's famous anywhere. He's an Icelandic coach.
Okay.
Is he famous? Is either from Iceland here? I shouldn't say anything. Are you from Iceland?
Yeah.
He didn't actually get such a good reputation in Norway, I must say, or in our club. He was kicked out at the end of the season and so on. But he was not so good with the psychological aspects, I would say. But he too brought with him lots of good things. For instance, I was kicked out of the team. I simply wasn't allowed to play. Didn't get me into the, I did everything. I was in fantastic form, but they simply didn't let me play. But he made some other youngsters play quite well, actually. Then the others substituted me. They played well. So the importance of dynamic. Rather than what was back again. Yes, the point is that you have to change your opening repertoire all the time. That's kind of my point. You have to think in new terms, because sometimes I have the impression that, say, in Karikin, for instance, I get a lot of preparations. I worked with Yevgeny Romanov, the grandmaster, great coach and everything. They present you with the truth. Computer analysis, but I like much more the dynamic approach, where you just get the position where you can fight. That's Magnus Carlsen, right? Isn't it? Just have to get out there and have an interesting dynamic position, and fight, and just not it's not about memorizing things, and sometimes football coaches too, that if you just train at one thing 1,000 times, you will become very good at it. But I believe more in just playing. I actually become a football coach myself these days for girls. 13-year-old girls is very, very fun. And there we have the same kind of conflict, because some people want you to just train at some things and then they will become very good. I believe in just playing and having fun. And having dynamic, new places on the field, and sometimes they should play on another with another coach, even another rise on another level. It's not kind of getting comfortable. The moment things get stuck and you're too comfortable, then you have to do something just to change. I believe that's what I learned from Petr Thordarson. Never get too comfortable, and then. Big problem with football is, of course, that we talked about it. Some trainers can either be wonderful or they can be horrible, because they're so important. That was quite disturbing for me, actually, as a football player, because in chess it was only me. And the inner conversation is quite important, what you say to yourself. And I thought I said good things to myself, I was building myself up. But in football, there, you were so vulnerable to what the coach was saying. And I really had a couple of coaches who destroyed the whole seasons for me. So obsessed about their system, I forgot totally about the human aspect, totally. It's, football is working with humans. Can I say that as a chess player, not working with humans, because it's chess men, they're not kind of humans, but you work with yourself. And as a chess coach, of course, you work with humans. The importance of humor, as everyone who's played football you know, is a lot of fun with the environment, and that's so important. It was very important for me. as a chess player was just on my own, how incredibly boring was that was. So that was maybe the main reason why I actually didn't continue. I quit. Well, I thought this is sad, lonely life. I want to have fun, be with boys. So humor is very important. Much more important than most things, I would say. Especially in Norway, I guess it's the same in England. And in Russia, I talk to them if it's fun or not. Who cares if it's fun or not? But we could have perhaps have more, a little bit more of that in Norway, I would say, because in Norway people basically wouldn't do it if it's not fun. But that's how it is. And in football is of course also more, they have so much more attention. So that's been quite useful actually. And I've been working with Magnus, he had to get used to all the attention. That was quite obvious already when he was 13 years old. And as in the future, what he is now, usually thought it would be them. We were quite, we talked about those things. You simply have to get used to it. It's people having harder times than that in the life around here, than, because Magnus sometimes got very stressed with all the attention and so on. It's possible to get used to that, just like kings and queens get used to it. You don't know how well the kings and queens or the royal family here is dealing with it, but at least they're used to it. But you have to handle it, it's part of it. I was visualizing myself as one of the lads, and when I suddenly was there, it didn't came as a, I wasn't totally shocked, because that often happens. You have to visualize it before, because sometimes you tend to think, oh, this is not me, I'm not that good or something. But if you've been visualizing before, then you're more prepared for to rise to the stars or something like that. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. I used to usually, sometimes use this quote, not really religious, but I think of even God had to visualize, he had to put words on things before he actually created the world. First he had to say it and visualize it. Yeah. And then, I click on this, or just, I have a good example. This might be interesting. Is it possible to get sound connected? You need the sound again? A journalist made this for me. It's quite nice because every time thing we do, I'm not good with taking pictures and so on, but it's no problem. Everyone else is taking pictures and are putting things in archive and so on. This is about visualizing.
Yes. So I want to become grandmaster this year. I also hope to become the youngest in Western of all time.
Is that realistic?
Yes, I think both are quite realistic.
His rating now is the highest in history.
It's really nice, it's just simply never stop.
Magnus is obviously a chess genius.
I mean, there was nothing to suggest that Norway was going to produce someone like Magnus Carlsen.
Okay, can your father still help you with your chess?
No, he can't.
Has it been a mystery to me that Magnus has become so good all the time? I have to pinch my arm.
Yeah, I hope to be Magnus Mester, but it was about time when the team came. Gjør mitt for å bli verdensmester, da.
Became world champion.
So not to become grandmaster this year.
It didn't come as a surprise. As you may see, we were visualizing it long time before it happened, and that's probably why it happened. I don't know. But visualizing is important. I wasn't so happy with Magnus actually saying these things, because then suddenly you got the pressure from outside. You can visualize it inside, but the moment you start saying it to journalists, you suddenly get expectations and disturbances. This Magnus doesn't seem to be affected about that, actually, because he settled things like that right from the beginning. But it was the perspective right from the beginning. I had the same vision of myself, but I thought it was so lonesome. I thought if I just trained half as much as the other, I could become world champion too. But what a boring life, I thought, when I was 20. No problem with the confidence. If it's true or not, doesn't matter. If you believe it, you get much higher than if you don't believe it, that's for sure. That's actually my last point. Johan Koss, I don't know if you remember him. He was a skater. He's only famous in Norway, I guess. Both famous in Norway. He took golds and everything in the Winter Olympiad in 1994. And he came, he was one of those guys who has come to MTG, to my school, and having his presentation, presenting things, the way he was thinking. And very interesting, I thought. Because when we made, I don't know if this is familiar for you, but when he took gold in 10,000 meters, the whole Nora followed that. And then they follow, it's very, very boring, of course, they just go round and round. But the interesting thing is that if they're following the schedule, if there is above or over or below the schedule, according to some probe or something. And then they're used to seeing the trainers saying things like that, two above, two under, and things like that, two, not seconds, but what is it? whatever. They were focusing on the result before, but as he explained then, he wasn't focusing on that at all. The only thing that the coach was focusing on, if his technique was good. And a little bit more bow, a little bit more arrow in, on the knees and things like that. I don't know. But it was just focusing on the technique, and with lots of small steps like that, suddenly the final result is fantastic. And that's elementary sport psychology, I would say. So journalists often ask about the results, and the coaches say they have to take one match at a time and things like that. They're focusing on the next match, on the process. You have to do the right thing, and then the result at the end will be fantastic. Actually, I remember Norman Schwarzenkopf. Do you remember him? Norman Schwarzenkopf. It's an American general in the Gulf War. Schwarzkopf.
Storming Norman.
Storming Norman. Storming what?
Storming Norman.
Yeah. He was having a presentation, or I remember it, because then he was interviewed by Norwegian TV and said, how did you win the war? Like it was him winning the war or something. That was easy. You just have to do the right thing. And so, okay, then what's the right thing then? Well, you just know. And you have a kind of a Protestant upbringing or something. You just know. But I was thinking he was doing, you have to do the right thing. And you do lots of right things right from the beginning, or just all the time actually. And suddenly miracles will appear at the end, because you do everything you do properly. So focus on the process, and the result will come. It's just a basic sport. That's for me as a chess coach. We don't measure our success in how many points we score. We measure our success in how much we've learned. So which means it's a success either way, which is good, because you shouldn't distract your confidence too much. You have to be a success person. If you kind of start having lots of failures, it distracts the confidence a little bit. So as long as the goal is to learn as much as possible, and not to score as many points as possible, then you of course vary your openings. For instance, Magnus Carlsen, the goal is to learn, the moment is to learn an opening, then it's time to stop playing that opening. And that was what we talked about when Magnus was 11 years old, and now he's played 3 or 4 games with that opening. Now we know this opening quite well, now we have to do something, we have to play something else. Which is a very different approach, I think, to the Russians, that we're supposed to learn and play things by heart or something. Stops the creative process too, I believe. You're much more creative when you see a position you've never seen before. And you think on your own, and you develop your skills in analyzing positions and so on. So it's a very similar thing, way of thinking from the sport. And it's the same thing. And that also means that everything is interesting. Sometimes coach, I had some sessions with some girls, Norwegian girls, which is a little bit of a challenge, I must say. Because for instance, when you look at something and they say, I don't play that opening, which means they don't follow, they're not interested in what you're talking about, because they don't play that opening. I don't understand what. Then I understand why they're not better, to put it that way. Because everything is pretty interesting, because the goal is to learn as much as possible. Which makes it very easy to be a chess coach, actually, because you can do anything. And sometimes these people ask, of course, what are you supposed to do and so on. It doesn't really matter, just do what you think is fun and interesting. My definition of a good book, for instance, chess book, is that if you open it, if you want to read it, and you actually read it, then it's a good book. It doesn't really matter what's written here. But if you want to read it, that means design is extremely important. Layout, such things.
Okay, I had my personal experience with the combination, I don't know.
And chess is fun too, in a different way, of course, meeting so many different people. The stranger the better, I think. I collect strange people at my school. All the traveling. And now suddenly get a lot of attention, especially in Norway, which is very stressful again. You have to get used to it again. Because when Norway play, when I play somewhere, I don't know, it's rapid, so the TV is here. And it's very popular. Everything is shown on TV in Norway these days. Chess is becoming beautiful. The meditating thing, that was really wonderful, because when I played chess, I was so much meditative, or I went into myself or something, and that was actually that was why I came back after a couple of weeks playing chess in the top form for football, which is I don't have time to tell you, but you just cannot. If you, I don't know, I think it's a clip on internet somewhere where Magnus starts playing, he starts thinking 5 minutes before making his first move against Kramnik. Just thinking, and then he played. He made his own decision. He opposed Kasparov, and soon after he sacked for Kasparov. That was Kasparov is so dominant; he tells you what to do. But at the middle there, Magnus, he's the boss. He knows what's best for him. And that's what you learn from chess: what's best for you. And that's the problem with football, of course, because then you have all these trainers saying that you have to do this and that, and it was really stressful, especially when you have some kind of qualified opinions about it yourself, or when you did it, when you were at your best. Breaking barriers, chess is wonderful like that, especially if you're successful. Play the best football, some of them in the world. Actually, I'm a debut against Italy. I remember Franco Baresi, he's a very quite small guy, by the way, I noticed. Very small. And Gianluca Vialli is famous here, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
I played against him. And Julian Hodgson, I played the same club with him. And Chelsea was his favorite club, and he couldn't believe I played against Gianluca Vialli. I was forward on the one field, and I saw another one who was having a lot of fun with the Norwegian defenders on the other side. But breaking barriers is incredibly important, and that's easy. Chess is good for that. Mental preparation, really, to be good at something. I mean, if you become good at something, it's easy to perhaps to become good at something else. Hope so. And lots of more, of course, lots of other things that chess gives you. I remember Short said that because we often think, is it worth it? We spend so much time on chess. And Short is absolutely sure. Oh yes, of course it's worth it. It's given him so much. With a non-understanding coach, it's a total catastrophe. Yeah. You need to treat this thing here. You have to treat everyone equally. That's very typical chess football coaches. That why should you do this when everyone else? Why should you go away 2 weeks? If everyone should behave like that, how would that be like? Things like that. But. You have to be treated. That's why it's quite interesting being a coach, I guess, because everyone is unique, and everyone has to be treated unique too. And that's quite difficult, I guess, with a big group. I think it's important. Pressure. I was thought I was playing a good match, and then I got only one at the newspapers were following you, especially the prof. The agents coming watching you on the talk, and suddenly get paid for playing soccer, which is totally destructive. It was for me. It destroyed the fun aspect. And of course, problem with travel, problematic to just travel away. So then it became difficult. It was impossible then. But if I had continued, I would have continued playing soccer, I'm absolutely sure. But I actually injured myself, so I didn't get the conflict for very long. I'm supposed to really show this one. I'm told to show this one. He wanted to get this, and I definitely Feyenoord. There were two coaches coming to my school. Unfortunately, I forgot it, so the meeting, so I had to take it on Skype. But they were there at my school, and they were very interested in chess and football because they believed chess would be good for the football players.
Yeah, Alex Ferguson was something about that.
A
little
while ago. Yeah. He said that he would, if he had his time again, he would get all his players learning to play blitz chess because that would be fantastic for sort of quick decision making. I mean, uh-huh. That's fantastic. Yeah. There were a few Norwegian players. Erik Thorstvedt, do you remember him? Erik Thorstvedt, he played for Tottenham. Goalkeeper. Disastrous start. But he is a fairly good chess player. 1600, I would say. But yes, I don't know. And that's maybe you have something more to say about that. But chess is hopefully good for everyone, isn't it? Yeah. Now, at least that's what we try to pretend. Or make people believe that chess is good for schools, school results. Total bullshit, isn't it? Or what?
Do we have any questions for Simen?
I really enjoyed the psychological aspect. That, you know, I think I can understand totally in football the emphasis you gave on being completely positive before the game, visualising success, because it's such a physical game. I mean, if we sit before the game, we've got a big game, we're playing a strong player, and we say, okay, I'm going to visualise my kingside attack working here, you know, bishop takes h7 check, I'm visualising the combination. But I mean, it's, of course, chess is, it's not so simple. I mean, I can see how that works more. What would you advise in football? What would you advise in chess? I mean, how do you visualise positively before a game? Because you don't know what opening the other game
is. I don't think it comes to visualise that bishop takes h7
works,
but I remember very well I played Spassky.
Yeah.
When I was 16 years old, I think. And I beat him. And that was, I remember very well, because that was kind of a psychological barrier, so I was thinking, okay, we start, it's just equal, the position is equal in the start, you make one move at a time, there's no reason that this one move at this position should be that enormously much better than my one move.
Yeah.
And I remember I was thinking that, actually. And that, I think it helped. But I played Kasparov too, and he was God in my mind. I thought I had to play like God too, and I played horrible, and I lost, of course, very quickly. At least that helped me, because my students later played Kasparov, and they played didn't very well against Kasparov, actually, and symbols and things like that. So, it's just to believe that they cannot make miracles, so of course they're very good players, but they can't make miracles. It's just, you can also make judgments. It's the same position, there and then. One move at a time.
But being positive before the game, be getting, I can see that can help, but I mean, how to do it better. So.
I think you can do a few tricks actually. For instance, by the way you're walking,
yeah.
Walk like this, you feel a little bit. If you walk like this, I'm strong. Things like this. I was very conscious about such things, and I was very conscious about focusing, because playing a game should be a big moment. So I was kind of building. First, I started building myself down. I walked down, I didn't take a shower. When I ate breakfast, when I ate lunch, and before the game and everything. And half an hour before the game, I used to go to the bath, take a bath. And 10 minutes before, I even put the aftershave, things I never used, and maybe even a tie. Just make this a big moment. This is the peak. And then I was coming like this, and I certainly didn't talk to anyone half an hour. The last half an hour, because I was so focused. Such things help, I'm sure. And we talked to Magnus about those things. So he's also very conscious about these things. It turns his day rhythm when it goes to bed. Everything is focused on being at top there and then. Here it's maybe 4 o'clock, is it? So I don't know when he wakes up, but he's conscious about it, that's for sure. And building yourself up is possible.
You can't beat the power of positive thinking. I mean, myself, I'm obviously not as strong, but whenever I play football or anything, I go into that match thinking I am going to win. And that is it. I don't care who I'm playing, it could be much stronger than me, but my philosophy, I'm always going in thinking I'm going to win.
Dostoevsky, they learn it at school, they have a cultural aspect I wasn't really aware of how enormous the old Soviet Union were culturally. So they had their good things for sure. I think they would profit. I think that it's good for producing excellence. I mean real excellence. You have to be more have more the passion aspect and the enthusiastic aspect. Average talents, I'm sure their approach is kind of much better, I don't know. But they produce grandmasters who wouldn't have become really grandmasters with my approach, I think, because I don't know. But for really brilliance, like Magnus Carlsen, has to be passionate. And for Norwegians, simply to keep them playing chess, it has to be passion too, because they would then, if not, they would just do something else. Isn't it like that? In Russia, it's about life and death. So important.
Has anyone here read Talent is Overrated? Yeah. This is quite interesting here. I mean, talent is, this book basically says...
Rob, can you talk to the microphone?
Can people hear me?
Yeah,
you should be able to hear me. That's okay. Basically, this book just says there is very little talent around in the world. Actually, everything can be trained. Now, this is, for me, the Russian mentality, because they have very, very specific training. Norwegian mentality, you have specific training as well, but it's more fun. The difference is, they do a lot more of it. Now, if you look at someone like Tiger Woods, extremely talented, but was he really that talented? He was picking up a golf ball at the age of two. His dad was an accomplished teacher. So he's been playing very specific golf all the way from the age of two. So it's no wonder he became very good. Mozart, from the age of three, his dad was an accomplished teacher and a ready composer. So very, very specific training all the way through. And this is the Russian school, very, very specific training all the way through. But personally, from my perspective as a parent, do I really want my child just doing very specific training on one thing? Okay, yes, he might get to the top, but what about the rest? So I might give up on my child not becoming the best chess player, because then we have the approach where he actually enjoys it. And for me personally, as a teacher, I want him to enjoy it. I don't want him to be forced into rigorous training every single day. Perhaps when a child gets to about 13, and they're one thing, like that boy over there, Dominic Klinger, right there. He loves chess. He will train every single day on his own, very specifically. He will not need anyone to put him through any routine, basically. So once you get to the age when you want to do that, and you want to devote the time to that, brilliant. But before that, I don't think so. And that's the Russian school from my perspective. I could be wrong, basically. Is there any more questions?
1,000 hours before he was 15. So it cannot be forgotten that he actually has spent 5 hours on chess on average every day since he was 9 years old.
And that's going
on. And it's not only fun, it's also an enormous amount of time. But it is because it's been. That's why he spent so much time on it. Especially the moments, because he would never do anything that's not fun.
And this talent is overrated comment, just out of interest, comes up from that very good book, Pump Up Your Rating. That's one of the things Axel Smith used in his training regime. Very good book. There's a question over there.
Yeah, have you got anything further to add other than words about positive thinking? That's all there is to it. Within the football world and the chess world, to clearly strong players who've got a psychological habit of choking, you know, the 74 in the Olympiad when he was about to become the world champion, and we were on board one, and we were both nervous because it was our debut. I knew he was nervous, and I was nervous, obviously. But basically, he tried to play too carefully. He thought, "I'm white. I'll not take any chances." And he played a little bit too passively. Uh-huh. And I knew I was playing good moves. And I said, at one point I sacrificed a pawn. And I said, I know I'm playing capo, but if you play like that, I am better. Uh-huh. And I actually missed a win.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not making anything of that, because in chess, as any sport, you know, you've got to put people away. Mm-hmm. And many other young players like me at the time, well, one or two certainly got winning positions against Karpov too, and did the same thing.
Yeah.
Because he just started to speed up, and he was a formidable player, certainly in those years. I think this is quite a common problem that stops some people getting to the peak of their ability.
I think it's,
and what would a football coach or a chess coach say to that?
It sounds very relevant. That's what I started talking about. But the visualizing thing.
Yes.
You have to visualize yourself as a winner when you were 10 years old, or that's already general, just a psychological thing. This has nothing to do with chess. It's all in your mind, isn't it? That's why you win the game.
Yeah, I think
it has to do with anything with your chess skills.
Yes.
So, sitting like this, staring me right in the eyes. Was that necessary for a world champion to behave like that?